This is the worldtomorrow.org, broadcasting worldwide on the internet from the Obedient Church of God.
By your eyes that you've probably been crying for him.
Yes, Father has been crying for 6,000 years because you and your ministers are so disobedient, generation after generation, and that includes all the churches and includes all the Jews who all move the Sabbath day to Friday in half the world. The stars in the sky don't mean anything to you. Genesis 1:14 doesn't mean anything to you. Lights will mark days. You're missing your appointment with the King of the Universe. You're breaking his heart.
But if I stay here just a little bit longer,
Church of God is standing all alone. It's preparing the way for Yeshua by making straight all the paths in order for Yeshua to return to the brethren in the place of safety where he just might. But we'll have to wait and see. But it does say, you shall make straight the paths of the Lord. And that's what we're doing. But I don't want to talk about it. You're breaking God's heart. Churches of God offshoots would obey. They're all claiming to be Philadelphians. Well, how can you be a Philadelphian if you're disobeying God? So sad. Magnificent horn section ushers in the broadcast. Bonjour, Paris, France. César, le président de l'ordre en France. Oh, yeah, late supper time in France. Coming up on supper time on the East Coast. And early supper time on the West Coast. Los Angeles, New York East Coast, Paris on the other side. All in the daylight period for your broadcast today on God's Sabbath, where we're teaching you about God and His way. Yes, indeed. No one else is teaching you to obey all of God's Bible. Every bit we can find. And right off the start, I want to tell you, all you ministers from the Worldwide Church of God, you are breaking the covenant. You are breaking the covenant because, humbly, I placed another $500 ad in the journal. There's no response to it. No response to it. They're locking up their ears. Closing their eyes. to the facts. To the facts that they're moving God's feast Sabbath days, 1 day early, 2 days late, 2 days early, 1 day late, with a phony averaging calendar. So they missed the appointment with God. And then their members work on God's holy days. What is so difficult with taking one click of your computer to know the correct day? Now, the correct day today is Sivan 25. But as usual, the Jews are ahead, and so all the offshoot churches of God are following the Jewish Hillel 2 calendar, which was made in 358 AD, and it's an averaging calendar. And let's get this straight. Yeshua never used an averaging calendar for God's holy days, or else we don't have salvation. You don't have salvation if you used an averaging calendar, if Yeshua used an averaging calendar, because then he would be breaking God's law and appearing on the wrong day. So get that idea out of your head that one minister said Yeshua used an averaging calendar. He did not. The Orthodox Jews to this day celebrate 2 days at the end of the month, both the 29th and the 30th. And the reason I'm mentioning that now, right off the start of the broadcast, because New Month Day is coming up either on the 17th or the 18th of June. Now, it's a borderline case on the 17th. It's barely visible, barely visible. In all likelihood, you won't be able to see it. So that means that the new month day will be on the evening of the 18th, and services will be on the 19th. So it'll be like a double header this week, with the services on Friday and the services on the Sabbath, Saturday, the seventh day. The point of all this is that your ministers miss their appointments with God. And if you are not at the station when the train pulls in, if you're not at the concert on the day of the concert where all the heavenly hosts are, do you think for 1 minute that God and all the heavenly hosts, you know, the 12 elders and the myriad of angels, are all going to say, oh, yeah, let's use Hillel's averaging calendar and let's all move God's Sabbath day to, well, in this case, the holy days, 1 day early, 2 days late, 2 days early, 1 day late. And in the case of the Sabbath day, yeah, let's put in an international dateline and have half the people on the world having the Sabbath on Friday. And then they all work on God's Sabbath day. This will cause your eternal death. And you know what Luke 12:48 says, that he who didn't know shall be beaten. And the reason you're going to be beaten is because you should have known. You should have picked up your Bible and blown the dust off of it, like Herbert W. Armstrong said, and studied it from cover to cover. And then you'd know the truths that the obedient Church of God know. And these truths determine your salvation, because the Sabbath day is the test commandment, and you can see that in your Bible quite clearly. Ezekiel 20:20, Sabbaths are a sign between you and God. But your ministers don't have that sign, because they move the Sabbath to Friday in half the world. And it's plural, Sabbaths, as in the feast days also. Your ministers are all moving the feast days 1 day early, 2 days late, 2 days early, 1 day late. And they are causing your eternal death, and definitely causing a beating for you to be beaten, because it says, he who did not know will be beaten. And your ministers aren't telling you. Your ministers aren't telling you that there are three feasts that are pilgrimage feasts, just like Yeshua went to Jerusalem but the days of unleavened bread with his family. That's where he taught in the temple when he was 12, because he was at Jerusalem. He wasn't in Nazareth. He wasn't in Bethlehem. He was in Jerusalem during the Feast of Tabernacles and the Feast of Unleavened Bread. And they were all gathered together in one place on the Feast of Pentecost. And that's what you have to do. I'm not going to take any guff from these ministers who lie and say they're keeping the three pilgrimage feasts by just having a service. They're not. You have to have three, count the fingers, three feasts, three pilgrimage feasts to a headquarters site. And indeed, coming up New Month Day this week, you shall worship God on New Month Day, which will be, depending on the sighting, either the day of the 18th daylight or the day of the 19th daylight. But it looks like it will be the 19th. Here's the point. We're here to help you, but we're not going to take any guff from these ministers, these lying devils who say they are obeying the Bible when they're clearly not obeying Deuteronomy 16:16 three times. Use your fingers to count up to three. You know, one is Feast of Tabernacles. You go on a pilgrimage to headquarters. Two is Pentecost. And if the disciples didn't show up at Pentecost, they wouldn't have gotten the Holy Spirit. And three is the Feast of Tabernacles. And you can't have one without the other, because one of the ministers says, oh, well, we follow the feasts as outlined in Leviticus. Oh, you do, do you? Well, the Leviticus doesn't command a pilgrimage for the Feast of Tabernacles. Leviticus does not bear note. When I say bear note, that's a special note you put in your book. That's a very salient point, so that you can know how to follow God's Bible and how to rebut these false ministers. So here's the point. Leviticus just lists the feasts. Deuteronomy tells you in 16:16 of Deuteronomy three times a year. So the minister says to me, well, will you follow Leviticus? And I said to him via email, well, then you can't have a Feast of Tabernacles, pilgrimage. You can't have a gathering, because Leviticus does not tell you to gather together for the Feast of Tabernacles. It just lists the Feast of Tabernacles. Can't have one without the other. So you want to throw away the book of Deuteronomy? Okay, you've got the book of Leviticus. Tells you that the list of the feast days. Only problem is it doesn't tell you to gather together. So the point is, you miss the appointment, you miss the concert, you miss Pentecost, you don't get the gift of the Holy Spirit, be a disobedient brat, and get thrown in the lake of fire. You know, it goes right back to the Israelites, where the Israelites were commanded to keep all the commandments. You know, it's very clear, classic scripture in Deuteronomy 27, verse 1. Keep all the commandments. All of them. Which includes, remember the Sabbath day to keep it holy, which is the seventh day in the whole world, not half the world. So the offshoot ministers are disobeying God and are breaking the covenant. You are breaking the covenant. I say that on the authority of this Bible, Deuteronomy 16:16, Ezekiel 46:3. You shall worship on New Month Day. Zechariah 8:19, there are four fasts. And there's a fast coming up on July the 5th, depending on the new moon sighting. So the fast of the fourth month on the 17th is on July the 5th. One of the four fasts of the Lord. Are you going to obey all the commandments of the Bible? Or are you going to be like the five foolish virgins and only be half full of oil? You know what happened to them? They were thrown out. Yeah, they're thrown out into outer darkness where there's weeping and gnashing of teeth. Teeth. That's how serious it is. Well, we've got the persistence to keep on preaching these facts, these truths, and we put in another $500 ad that says the header to the ministers, it's addressed to the ministers, you don't have the right to be stupid when you are causing the eternal death of your members. Because remember, the Bible clearly says that if you practice a lie, you will not be in the kingdom of God. Read it for yourself, Revelation 22, verse 15. Go to the back of the book. And you ministers who preach lies, you won't be in the kingdom either. Because it says in Revelation 21, 27, anyone who breaches a lie shall not be in the kingdom. So we are the Romans 9, 28 work. We are restoring all things because nobody else is. So in this ad, we've got as the first point, you ministers all move God's Sabbath to Friday, the sixth day in half the world, by following a phony international dateline. Two, you ministers all willfully disobey Deuteronomy 16 and only have one pilgrimage feast. Three, you ministers refuse to have God's commanded four fasts, with the next fast coming up on July the 5th. Next, we'll go into the phony 358 averaging calendar, 358 AD averaging calendar, that makes God's moedim, and moedim are appointments. You know, you want to see the concert, you want to see the presidential address, you've got to be there on the exact moedim, the exact appointed time. Moedim means appointed time. You've got to be there at the appointed time. If you're not there at the appointed time, it goes on without you, and you're just out of luck. So there you go. You can't use an averaging calendar. And why would you use an averaging calendar? With one click of the computer, you can know the true date. Well, this is a witness against them, the ministers. And they're going to have refused to obey Ezekiel 46:3, that you should hold a worship service every new month day. And they refused to have the big last dinner on Nisan the 12th. That's a dinner that has the foot washing, and that closes with a hymn. And you have it in the homes. You don't have it in a restaurant. You have it in the homes. Passover was always held in the homes. It wasn't held in big halls with everybody gawking at each other's repenting of their sins. It's a private matter between you and God. It's done in your homes, in your houses, privately between you and God. So we are helping you to understand God's way and how do you, for you to have a personal relationship with God. Just very important to have it in your home and not in a hall where everybody's walking around like it's a solemn mass, like it's a Catholic mass. Doesn't work like that. You have your Passover. In this case, we're talking about the last dinner. That's the topic we're on the 12th. Because Yeshua had the last dinner, which was, he longed to have the Passover. But he couldn't be because he was the Passover lamb. So that stops the argument right there that it was the Passover. It wasn't. Point being is that he, Yeshua, said, take the bread and the wine in remembrance of him. That's part one. That's very important, to remember him. That's his night. Then two nights later is the Passover. Because if you look in your Bible, you'll see quite clearly that he was crucified at 12 noon, and he was sentenced at 9 a.m. Just look in Mark, and you'll see the hours and the times. He was crucified at 12 noon. He was... Oh, it's so frustrating. Let's try this again. Sentence was passed at 12 noon, and he was crucified at 9 a.m. Sentence was passed at 12 noon, he was crucified at 9 a.m. How can you be crucified before your sentence is passed? Obviously, he stayed in the dungeon and then was crucified the next morning. And that's backed up by Roman law that states you can't have a man crucified on the same day sentence is passed. The point is, they are all breaking the covenant of the Passover by having the Passover on the wrong day. Now we're switching to the Passover. So you have the last dinner on the 12th, and then 2 days later, you have the Passover on the end of the 14th, not the beginning of the 14th. And all you ministers, I'm telling you, you can't have the Passover before the lambs are slain, as you have done in worldwide since day one, on the end of the 13th, the beginning of the 14th, before the lambs are slain. You must have the Passover after the lambs are slain, or you are taking the Passover in an unworthy manner. And that's why some of you are weak and ill, and why some of you have died. Because unworthy describes the action, not the actor. And then you have all these ministers beating you over the head, saying to you, you know, you're not worthy to take the Passover, you know, you gotta repent, you're not worthy to take the Passover. Here's the point. It's the manner in which you take it that Corinthians is referring to. The manner. You shouldn't be drunk. You shouldn't be satiated with food. You should be of a clear mind. And then you take the Passover. It refers to the action, taking it in an unworthy manner, being drunk, or being satiated with food. You want to be alert when you take the Passover. So we are restoring all things, and these are the most critical things that affect your salvation. We've got a lot of information that we know all about things going on in the world. We know all about who's running the world. It's not the politicians that you elect. They don't run anything. They're on leashes. And if they get off their leashes, they get killed. They get murdered, just like Kennedy got off his leash and was killed. We'll tell you more about that on the Committee of 300 if there's time today. I've got a dynamite broadcast for you. I'm going to give you a bit of a study into God's name. Yeah. Do you know that the Arabs, you know, say that they're, you know, Allah be praised, Allah be praised, yeah. Well, that's not the name of God. Get the file folder here just to tell you that in the Quran, Allah is not the name of God. What the problem is in Islam, Allah is not even the supreme God. They've got 360 pagan gods, in fact. Nobody knows that. The point is, I want to tell you so that you can answer these people that are going to tell you that, oh, we're all worshiping God. Allah is Jesus. You know? No, it isn't. No, it is not. Problem being, the point being, is that when you translate Allah, it means just generically God. It doesn't mean El Shaddai. It just generically means God. The same way that I am a man and my name is Lawrence. And you have Father, who is God, and his name is El Shaddai. I'll give you more information on that. But the point is that when you hear that we're all worshiping the same God, that's a lie. Because they've got 360 gods. 360. And using the name Allah doesn't refer to any particular God. It just is generic, like man. Man. So I'm a man, but my name is Lawrence. God the Father is the true God, and his name is El Shaddai. Now, there's a lot more to it than that. You know, we'll get into Yahweh and all the rest of it as time permits. But it's important to have the correct form of addressing God. You can always address him as Father, and that'll stop all of it. And you can always address Yeshua. You don't speak directly to Yeshua, by the way, but you can always refer to him as Yah, Y-A-H, because there are different derivations of Y-A-H-W-E-H, or Y-E-H-W-A-H, or Y-A-H-W-A-H, or Y-E-H-W-E-H. Give you a secret. God's real name, the Father, is I Am. That's all I'll say for now, because we've got to get into the broadcast. But we've got that for you, and we've got an updates on Jade Helm, and we've got updates on the water shortage that's being caused deliberately by HARP, because in California, all of the clouds, all of the water is in the skies is being pushed off the shore by HARP, H-A-A-R-P. They're deliberately causing the drought, and they're killing you. They're killing you. And this is going to be just like the 1930s. Then they're going to buy up the property for pennies on the dollar. That's what they did in the 30s. They crashed the system, crashed all the stocks, all the businesses. And then for the people to have enough money to eat, they had to sell their businesses. And the elite bought them up for pennies on the dollar. And the same thing is happening right now, right in front of our eyes, only 10 times worse. So we'll tell you about the water shortages via HARP, H-A-A-R-P, and they're going to, you know, you think they're taking your guns away from you? They're taking your water away from you. And food prices are soaring. They've killed all the chickens with the bird flu. Chicken prices are going to go through the roof. And the same thing with any type of meat products, because all the cattle are dying. They're doing this deliberately because the Georgia guides don't say they're going to kill 90% of us, and they're killing us right now. And if it wasn't bad enough that they're depriving you of your water, and water, oh, do you know how much water costs in the Middle East? Hey, how much is a gallon of water in the Middle East? In the Middle East, 17 American dollars for 1 gallon of water. And a person needs at least half their weight in water a day, which means that if you weigh 200 pounds, you're going to need 100 ounces. Now, a gallon of water contains 128 ounces. So you might as well round it off, because you're going to need some water for brushing your teeth. So, $17 a day for you. $17 a day for your husband. That's $34 a day for water if you're living in Afghanistan. Look, they are deliberately bringing down the whole world to bring in the New World Order, and we understand it, and we know who's doing it. We know it's the Committee of 300. You know, we got all these ministers railing against Obama, or railing against Bush, or railing against Cameron and British Prime Ministers. Look, there's a committee that runs this world, the Committee of 300. We'll tell you about that. We'll also tell you about fleeing. That'll be important, because those who will escape to the mountains. Ezekiel 7:16, you got to be in a mountain. You got to be able to move around, because there's going to be paratroopers on the streets. Yeah, they're going to paratroop in. And they're going to be firing shots. And you're going to hear heavy equipment rolling down your street, especially in Texas. So you're going to be hearing gunshots and heavy equipment. And then they're going to come to your house. And they're going to say, don't worry, just stay in your houses. This is only a drill. Do you know why they're doing that? So that when the real deal happens, then everybody will be staying in their houses, because they're training you. They're training you to comply, just like you're being trained to be groped as you go to the airport. You're being trained to be pulled over on the side of the highway for no reason. There isn't any freedom in America. We're under martial law already. We just don't know it. It just isn't overt. It's covert. And Jade Helm, if there was any exercise like Jade Helm in any other country, you'd say they're practicing for martial law. If you heard that there are military tanks, Humvees, all types of aircraft in the sky, from black helicopters to jets overhead, conducting a military exercise in the streets of Russia, you'd say they're preparing for martial law. So obvious. But your media, the Illuminati media, they don't, not a word out of them that this is martial law. Well, this is the worst situation that's ever hit America, worse than the start of the Civil War. And you hear nothing of it on the media about the seriousness of it. So we'll tell you about the seriousness of Jade Helm and what to expect and how to protect yourselves. And we'll tell you about how to be a follower of the way. That's right, the way. That's what's mentioned about 7 times in the Bible, the way. There's a particular way you've got to live. And in our ad, I'll hold it up for the camera here. See the beautiful colors? And the full page, tells you the basic tenets that all of the offshoot churches are breaking. And if they're breaking it, they're one of the 5 foolish virgins, and they won't be in the kingdom. It's that simple. If you don't show up for God's holy days on the correct day, you're one of the 5 foolish virgins. If you're moving God's Sabbath day to Friday in half the world, just like the poop moves it to Sunday, you're one of the 5 foolish virgins. If you're refusing to follow New Month Day, where you shall worship, and indeed the whole world shall worship, Isaiah 66:23, the whole world shall worship God on New Month Day. Try to get out of that one, eh? But your minister say, no, we don't worship God on New Month Day. No. Well, they'll be having to worship God on New Month Day, whether they like it or not, when they're after they go through the tribulation, and then they come up in the second resurrection, if they're even that lucky. Because, if Hebrews 10:26 cuts in, Hebrews 10:26, or if we go on sinning willfully after receiving a knowledge of the truth, there's no sacrifice for sins, but a terrifying expectation of judgment and the fury of fire which shall consume the adversaries. Brackets, consume the ministers. Hebrews 10:26, because they've all seen this ad stating that you shall worship on New Month Day, but they say no. They've seen the ad that says that you shall fast to the Lord. Well, they won't do it on July the 5th, on the 4th month. They won't have the Passover. They'll mix it all up with the Lord's dinner, foul that all up, Brack being there on the wrong days and focusing on the wrong things, taking it in an unworthy manner. You see, they've corrupted the covenant. Malachi 2:8-9, you ministers have corrupted the covenant. On the authority of this Bible, I tell you, you've corrupted God's covenant. You've gone against the Bible words, and you're damnable liars, all you ministers, because you say you obey this Bible, and you don't. And that includes all of the churches of God, all of the offshoot churches of God, every one of them, except the obedient church of God. And that's why God raised us up. And this is a short work of Romans 9:28. Others claim this is a short work. What's their short work? The short work of teaching error? No, the short work of preparing the way, making straight the paths. That's our job. So we want you to tell your ministers to repent. Tell your ministers to follow the Bible. Make your ministers obey God's Bible. Tell them to obey. Tell them this is life and death. Send them all a copy of our ads. Put some pressure on them. They read them in the journal, but if they get the feeling that their members are now aware of this, then they don't want to lose their members. They just might repent, lest God should come and destroy the earth. So we're going to turn the hearts of the children, the members, the children of God. We're going to turn the hearts of the children of God to the Father. And we're going to turn the Father's heart to the children by the way we sing the hymns with meaning and purpose. Therefore, let's now enter the throne room and all please rise. Face the north heavens where Yeshua and the Father are. Raise your arms. Worship. Bow your head in humility. Close your eyes in sincerity. Mighty loving Father El Shaddai, thank you for the truth you've shown us from your word that was hidden all these years. And we have grown in grace and knowledge, and we have repented, because that's how you grow in grace, as you know, Father, that grace is repentance, a short time to repent in. Father, thank you for the great sacrifice of Yeshua, and how he went through all his trials. Help us to go through our trials, just like Yeshua did, and no matter what happens to us, starting on Jade Helm, we vow to be true to you and true to every jot of your word and to never deny you, Father. Never deny your Sabbath day. Never deny your way in the Bible. Please look after our brethren in Pakistan. We always put them in the beginning of the prayer. They are also following your way. They also follow, as you've seen them, your angels report. As we all have a recording angel that records what we do, and they're all reporting, angels are reporting to you that our brethren in Pakistan are following, we have taught them. And let this be a witness against all the ministers around the world that our brethren in Pakistan wait for the Sabbath day. And let this be a witness against them and in favor of every jot of your Bible. Father, thank you for the obedient Church of God, because we learn every Sabbath ourselves as we come before you and you instruct us. So now we turn the service over to your hands and ask for your instruction and ask for your Holy Spirit and ask for your blessing on this service, both the speaking and the hearing, and especially help the people to understand on the videotapes. Ask this all in Yeshua HaMashiach's holy righteous name, our soon arriving King of the world. Amen. Yeah, it's not our work. It's God's work. He didn't reveal everything to Herbert W. Armstrong in order that you could grow. In order that you could grow in grace and knowledge. And now, as we're in the throne room, we want to praise Father. And here's our beautiful 1934 worded hymnal for camera one. And turn to page number 5. It's getting to be a theme around here. I like this song so much. You want to sing it? Yes? Sing to the Lord with a cheerful voice. It's hymn number 76 in the Worldwide Church of God hymnal. And it's called All People That on Earth Dwell. But in our book, it's called A Song of Joyful Praise. You see how this is more salient than, well, it says A Song of Joyful Praise. That's the original title before it was changed. It's the 100th Psalm. So let's sing out to the Lord with cheerful voice and praise Him, because He is worthy. He is worthy of praise. So sing out.
All people that on earth do dwell, sing to the Lord with cheerful voice, serve Him with joy, His praises tell. Come ye before Him and rejoice.
sang out and told him that you are his sheep. For his sheep he doth us take. And tell him that his truth is firmly stood. Now let's turn to page number 88. Blessed and happy is the man who does never walk astray. Hymn number 1 in the worldwide. And I would suggest that you sing out, that you sing out to your Father and tell him, tell your Father that you meditate on his law, that you meditate on his law. That's right. Sing out. Hymn number 88. Hymn number 1 in the old world, in the 74 worldwide. Indeed, you said you place your delight on God's law. That's a great admonition if your children said, Dad, I place my delight on your words. Yes, I do, Dad. I delight on your words. Let's turn to For Even From My Youth, O God. Page number 91 in our hymnals, the original 1934 hymnals, 52 in the blue hymnals. And let's tell Father some admonitions here. For even from my youth, O God, by thee have I been taught. You're going to tell him that. And then you're going to ask him, this is important. Sing out, forsake me not when I am old and gray. Ask him. Don't ask, you don't receive. And you're going to ask him to bring you from the depths of trouble, from the depths of Jade Helm in verse 2, from the depths of earth below. Yes. And then you're going to praise him. O God, the heaven's height exceeds thy perfect righteousness. Or who is like you, Father, who has performed such mighty deeds? Tell him! He just might turn his heart towards you.
Glory to God, my youth.
Very good. Oh, please be seated. Can't wait to sing that song in the place of safety. Yes, that would be wonderful. And we're going to take a generator to the place of safety. And we're going to take these big speakers that you've seen in outdoor concerts. We're going to ship them in a shipping container. You know, we're basically all set to move. We know we've got the vehicles. You know, we even got the sound truck. That's like a 35-foot U-Haul that carries all the sound equipment in it. Then we got the Ark, which is a larger trailer, which would carry the necessities, washers, and dryers, and generators, and furniture, everything you need. Now, we could be in a cave, too. We'll see how God works it out. But there's nothing in the Bible to say you shouldn't ship tools and equipment to Jordan in a shipping container. Not to mention the vehicle, because you won't be able to buy or sell. You will not be able to buy or sell. So you'd better have everything with you. Now, I believe also God will feed us, just like he did before in the wilderness, because this is one of the keys that we are going to be leaving suddenly, the same way God had the Israelites leave suddenly. And God's going to work the same miracles again. You know, talking with my correspondents that how God's going to do this. And it's very important to know that it's all in God's hands. Yes, it's all in his hands, just like he did it in the days of Pharaoh. Right now we are in Egypt. We are trapped here. We are trapped here with Jade Helm coming up. I'll tell you more about that later, but there's the point I want to make right now. It's going to be God's doing. And when he sets us free, it will be quickly, but we've got to respond. You know, we've got to come before the 1,335 days, and definitely before the 1,290 days. That means before the second half of the 3.5 years. And the 7 years might just start in the next couple of months. You know, July, August, September. September the 13th. Remember, the poop is going to address the United Nations on September the 23rd. He's going to address Congress somewhere around the 22nd of September. And the Shemitah is September the 13th, where the tomato should start hitting the fan. That's right. So, just a couple of months from now, and however God works it out, once the 7 years start, we are definitely heading towards Jerusalem before the 1,335 days. We'll take it a step at a time. First we get over to Jordan. Then we go on. If we go early, we can have a tour of Jerusalem. We can walk the same footsteps that Yeshua walked. We could spend a month in Jerusalem before the real serious trouble starts. So that's why we want to leave early, so we could spend some time in the Holy Land. You know, so we can spend a day in the area of the cenacle, where the upper room was, where the Last Supper was held, the Last Dinner was held. We can spend some time in that area. If we leave everything to the last minute and just have to race over to Jordan, we lose out. So look forward to us being led by God once the 7 years start, to us seriously thinking of leaving for Jerusalem at the beginning of the 7 years, toward the beginning of the 7 years, preferably during the first year of the seven. Now, all kinds of trouble can be happening in the meantime, so I might as well just prepare us a little bit more for what's coming up, what we're going to have to contend with, told you on June the 15th, not July the 15th.
Ministers have got it wrong as usual.
They've got it wrong and they're saying July the 15th. No, it's been moved up. It's been moved up and there'll be
paratroopers dressed in civilian clothes.
And they'll be coming down out of the sky onto your street. And into the red zones for sure, like Texas and Utah and the southernest part of California. These are all red zones. Red zones. And this isn't going to be a picnic. This is not going to be a picnic. I want to tell you, this world is controlled by the Committee of 300. We'll get to that later. But there are also territorial spirits. There are territorial spirits that govern countries and certain parts of countries. That's why Jade Helm is so serious. You see, bear note, Satan has organized his demonic forces into a hierarchy. Now there is a form of rank, and that's indicated in the description in Paul's letters of principalities, that's one rank, authorities, another rank, that's two, powers, three, dominions, four, thrones, five, and world rulers, six. Now, when you're dealing with these, in certain areas, there can be what's known as Katokhazmeroth. And these are very, very evil, powerful demons that are in charge. They're like the General Schwarzkopf, you know, they're like the Pattons. They aren't the pushovers. And there is a degree or depth of wickedness between the demons. They're evil. But let's look at Matthew 12:45 so we can get an indication of what we have to deal with. Let's turn to let's turn to scripture, Matthew 12:45. So here we see, you know, you cast out the demon out of one guy, one person. And Matthew 12:45 says, then he goes and takes with him seven other spirits, more wicked. Now here's the point. People just read over that. And they think, oh, it's just seven more spirits. No, no. Let's underline the word more. More wicked than himself. I want you to understand this. There is a hierarchy in the demon world. And let's read it again. There he goes and takes with him seven other spirits. Now underline this word, more wicked than himself. That's why the last state is worse than the first. But here's the point. Some demons are more wicked than others. And Matthew 12:45, if you read it correctly, and I open your eyes to that, you'll see what you're dealing with. Now, we're in Tennessee, and from my knowledge, certain demons don't, I'm not going to say anything more than, you know, we know like Chicago is just hell on wheels. No, there's some kind of trouble demons there that are just bad. It's a bad, bad area. I'm just showing you there's a difference. Hopefully, we're not going to talk about this too much because we don't want to stir up anything with any demons trying to compete with each other. But in Tennessee, it looks like it's too small an area with too few people and scattered around, and people without money and people that are, you know, just struggling to get by and can't be lured into all of the debauchery of the world. And this is a big Baptist region here. But the point is, I sure wouldn't want to live in Chicago. And in fact, when I had gone to Chicago a couple of times, I could just feel it. I could just feel it around me. And by the way, the same thing with Dallas. When I was in Dallas, it just, well, I was on edge all the time. On edge all the time. Even in the nice areas, in the rich people's houses. And I stayed in a rich place. But still, it didn't feel right. Oh, it was pretty, and the whole lawns were all just manicured, and everything was perfect. You had all these rules. You couldn't even park your car in your driveway. You couldn't even park your car on the street. You had to park your car inside a garage at your house. And everything was just perfectly manicured and beautiful. But it didn't feel right. It felt uneasy, as if something was watching you, as if some force was there. So that was Dallas for me. And that was Chicago for me. Let's go to Mark 9:29, so we know more about what we're dealing with. So you just learned that some demons are more wicked than others because your Bible says so. Your ministers don't tell you what you're dealing with. You got to know your enemy. You got to know your enemy. So Mark 9:29. So he said to them, This kind can come out by nothing but prayer and fasting. So look out. There's a kind that is really bad, really tough, that you don't want to mess with. So underline the words, this kind. So I'm teaching you that there are different kinds. There are different kinds. And remember, I told you that they're in different principalities and different regions, and they're all got control. And this is serious, because I'm hoping that in Tennessee, that we don't have any, you know, super bad demons. They're all bad, but no super bad ones, because it's a piddly small area. And just like you wouldn't assign General Schwarzkopf to a little tiny town, you'd assign Schwarzkopf to Chicago, or Dallas, or New York, or Washington, D.C. We wouldn't assign him to a little town of 400 people. So hopefully things won't go too badly for us. Let's tell you more, because Jade Helm is coming up, and it's all satanic, so let's see what else. I put your mind at ease, hopefully, that we're not going to be dealing with any really, really bad, bad demons. They're all bad, but I mean, I wouldn't want to be dealing with Schwarzkopf or Patton. Now, let's go to Ephesians 6:11. And remember, this is all to prepare us for Jade Helm, which is just like Hitler. And we're the Christians. In the terms of Christians, we're really the Netzerai and the people of the way. Rare note, we're the people of the way. But just for the new listeners out there, we'll just say Christians. So Christians are classified as disruptors and will be rounded up, are automatically on the red list, and will be rounded up and taken away. Let's go to Ephesians 6:11. Ephesians 6:11. Here's your defense. Put on your armor. So this is what you got to do before Monday. You got all day tomorrow to put on your armor. You've been putting on your armor, hopefully, all your life, all year. But here's your, like, there's no sense me just telling you what the demons are like. Got to tell you how to defend yourself. Put on the whole armor of God, that you might be able to stand against the wiles of who? Who are you going to stand against? principalities, authorities, powers, dominions, thrones, world rulers, dunamis and katakasmarov. I'm not going to get into those types. I don't like spending too much time on that, so I don't attract them. All right. So that's who you are going to be putting your armor on against. And if you're going to put on armor, that means they're going to be attacking you. Let's go to Mark 9, 29. And there isn't any other minister, anyone, in, any other preacher in the worldwide Church of God preparing the people for Jade Helm. Interesting. Mark 9, 29. Back to this kind can only come out by nothing but prayer and fasting.
So remember, there are the kinds.
Now let's go to 2 Corinthians 2:11. 2 Corinthians chapter 2 verse 11.
Scripture.
2 Corinthians 2, 11. I got the pages stuck together here. I'm trying to get the pages untangled. It's humidity here. 2 Corinthians 2, verse 11. Lest Satan should take advantage of us, for we are not ignorant of his devices. So, we know that Satan doesn't operate haphazardly. We know that he assigns certain demons to certain areas. We know that he has a plan. And that we are not ignorant of his devices. 1 John 5:18. 1 John 5:18. States. Here's the good news for you. Save some good news for you. All right? Don't want you to be too rattled. 1 John 5:18. We know that whoever is born of God does not sin. And that means you don't repeat your sin. You don't repeat your sin, you know. If you're a boozer, you cut down on the booze. So that you don't feel tipsy. Okay, that doesn't mean you don't drink, because Noah, the first thing Noah did was made himself a vineyard. And you are to drink. The Bible says you are to drink to cheer the heart, and at the feast, have whatever you want, and it even says strong drink. I'll give a sermon on that, that wine is to cheer the heart. But you're not supposed to be drunk. And the same thing with eating. You're not supposed to be stuffed. You're not supposed to eat until you're stuffed, and you're not supposed to drink until you're drunk. You stop drinking before you're drunk, and you stop eating before you feel stuffed or bloated. Here's the point. Back to the wicked one. Here's the good news. Dot, dot, dot. The wicked one does not touch him. Have you got that? We know that whoever is born of God does not sin. But he who has been born of God keeps himself. That means you don't continue, you don't stay in a sin. You know, you get up and you fight off that sin. And the wicked one does not touch him. That's a guarantee from God's word. So you've got a guarantee from God's word. Now, we that are of God, we know it. And the whole world lies under the sway of the wicked one. That's in verse 19. In verse 20, he's given us understanding that we may know him and who is true. And we are in him. We are in him who is true, in his Son, Jesus Christ. This is the true God and the eternal life. So watch out. If you have got children and they are not in God's way, I hate to say this, but you can expect your children to be having trouble. Yeah. Satan will go after them because he can't touch you. He cannot touch you. We've just read it here. 1 John 5:18. Dot, dot, dot. The wicked one does not touch him, but he'll kill your children. He'll cause trouble in your families. That's why your children should be told, you know, they'd better think seriously, because Satan will go after anybody that you love. That's just the way Satan is. If he can't get you, it's just like the mafia. You know, the mafia can't get you because you got too many bodyguards, or you've hardened yourself. You've hardened your environment. You know, they'll go after your relatives. They say, and if you don't care if you get killed, they'll say, well, we'll kill your child. Yeah, we'll kill your children. You don't do what we say, we'll kill your children. We'll kill your mother, we'll kill your grandmother, we'll kill your dog. We'll kill everyone around you unless you do what we say, unless you comply, take the mark of the beast. Well, we're not going to take the mark of the beast, but Satan will grow after our children the same way as the mafia is. Mafioso is. We are dealing with evil. We can't help it. We don't want to deal with evil. But we have to deal with evil. You know, Daniel didn't want to deal with evil. God had to send an angel to Daniel. You know, because his... Oh, and the angel was delayed for 21 days. So that prince of Persia, which is the prince of Iran, Iran is a real powerful demon. And he, the prince of Persia, held up the angel, I believe it was Gabriel, for 28 days till Gabriel got Michael to come. And they both booted out the prince of Persia. Yeah. So here's the deal. Even the angel Gabriel was hindered by the prince of the kingdom of Persia. That shows you how powerful these demons are, that they could even hold up Gabriel. This is, you know, the scenario is in Daniel 10. And it's very explicit. In fact, it's the most explicit support for the idea, not the idea, the fact of nationalistic spirits, because this is the prince of Persia, this is the prince of Iran. So when the demon wasn't running havoc in Iran, he, the demon, which was Persia, when he wasn't in Persia, he came to hassle Gabriel and hassle Daniel. So we're going to be hassled on Jade Helm, but we're going to pray out for God's protection. And we're going to resist. We're going to resist. Because it says, if you resist Satan, he'll flee from you. So when trouble starts on June the 15th, which is just a day away from now, you better be praying the night before, the day before, putting on your spiritual armor and preparing. Look, I'll tell you, there is at least one high-ranking demon assigned to each country. We know that from the Prince of Persia. Okay? With lesser demons to assist. Now, Michael is portrayed as a special guardian or protector over Israel. In Daniel 10... What is it, 13 to 21, somewhere around there. Like, looking in my Bible here and see if we can find that for you. You got it in my notes too. So we're going to Daniel 10. Okay. Then we're going to 13, starting there. Here you get the story, you know, that the demon of Persia withstood for 21 days. Yeah. Pretty tough situation there. Now here's the punchline, verse 21. Michael is our prince, Michael. And we don't pray to angels, but we call on God to protect us. And we're a very small group here. So you know that according to the Bible, all the eras of the church that aren't Philadelphian, you know, they're all going into the tribulation. They're all going to be persecuted. They're going to have their heads cut off. So that means they're going to be locked up in boxcars, shipped to FEMA camps, and have their heads cut off. So the Bible says, the part about having your heads cut off, and there's 60,000 guillotines in the United States. That's over 1,000 guillotines for each state of the Union. Over 1,000 in each state. They want to kill off 90% of the population. It says so on the Georgia Guidestones. And it does say also in the Bible that 90% will perish. 90% of the people will perish. That's pretty serious. That's very serious. And we are sealed. Remember, we're sealed. In Isaiah 8:16, we're sealed. Seal the law among my disciples. That's important. But there'll only be a tenth left before this is all over. Isaiah 6:13. Write this down. Bear note. 90% of the people will be dead. Thus says the Lord, Isaiah 6:13. You want to go there? Read it for yourself. Isaiah 6:13. But yet a tenth will be in it. And it gets worse. And that tenth will be for consuming. Yeah. So even that tenth will be picked on. Serious. Only one-tenth, which means 90% killed. And this is the time, you know, where Damascus is destroyed. This is our time. This is our time. And Damascus is half destroyed already. You know, all torn apart. It's all torn apart right now. It isn't totally destroyed. But if you want the time frame, it involves Damascus in verse 8 of chapter 7 of Isaiah. You know, where Ephraim, the USA, will be broken so that it will not be a people. And the head of Ephraim, you know, Samaria, S-A-M-E-R-I-C-A. Point is, this is what we're up against. 90%, only a tenth will be in it. I didn't say that. God said that. Until all the cities are laid waste and without inhabitant. Isaiah 6:11. Then I said, Lord, how long? And he answered, until the cities are laid waste and without inhabitant. And why is this happening? Basically, because the ministers aren't listening. Now, wouldn't it be ironic that the reason that Jade Helm is kicking in now is because we've put in three full-page ads into the Journal magazine. Three of them. This is the third one. Full page. You can't miss it. There's no way you can miss it. Because it's the only ad in the Journal that's multicolored. And this one that I just did has got yellow highlights. Got red letters all over the place. It's got blue highlights. It's got green highlights. It's got blue letters. Can't miss it. You know, it jumps right out at you. Jumps right off the page at you. That's our third ad. And now Jade Helm kicks in. Wouldn't it be ironic that if the ministers of the worldwide Church of God had responded to our humble ads of admonishing them to get right with God, that all this trouble wouldn't be happening to America, and God would send his angels, same way that God has sent his angels before to protect people and to change world events? Wouldn't it be ironic that because the ministers have not listened to the three full-page ads in the last 3 months, they've ignored it and blocked their ears and closed their eyes, that now Jade Helm kicks in to start it. Timing's pretty good on God's part. I didn't do that. Oh, I wrote the ads, but God led me to do that. The timing seems to be just about perfect. Yeah, three ads, 3 months, and now Jade Helm kicks in. Was even moved up a month from July the 15th. Well, here we go again. We're into the end days. And the Lord is aroused against his people. Who's the Lord aroused against? Let's go to Isaiah 5:25. Who's the God angry at? Who's the Father angry at? Eh? And why? Why? You gotta ask who? You gotta ask why. Well, 25 says, the Lord is aroused against his people. Well, why? Why is Father angry at his people? Go back to verse 24, ... Because they have rejected the law of the Lord of hosts. The ministers of the Worldwide Church of God offshoots have rejected Deuteronomy 16:16 and still refuse to have three feasts, pilgrimage feasts a year. They refuse to have new moon day coming up this Wednesday or Thursday. They refuse to have the first of the four fasts of the Lord coming up on July the 5th. Because you have rejected the law of the Lord, ... the Lord's anger is aroused against his people. He has stretched out his hand against them and stricken them. Uh-oh, their carcasses were as refuse in the middle of the streets. Do you know that the Jade Helm exercises, they caught him on film practicing in Florida, practicing early, and they are throwing people to the ground. They're using their own crew as the citizens, so the army is using a certain army non-commissioned officers as cannon fodder, and they're practicing throwing people to the ground, jumping on their backs so they can't breathe. That's how the cops kill so many people, because they put their knee into your back and you can't breathe. You disrupt your lung function, not to mention choking you outrightly, which is totally illegal. Anyways, here's the point. They are throwing people to the ground, and then after they knock you unconscious and disable you, then they march you in a line the same way in the concentration camps in single file. Here's the point. They're doing it right now in Florida in their practice drill, and we are going to be destroyed. It says so. It says that in Isaiah that we are going to be destroyed, and all the cities are going to be laid waste. And it says that in Isaiah 6:13, that only a tenth will survive. And we've given you the answer as to why. Because you have refused to obey. You rejected the law. Just go to verse 20 or 24. Because the ministers rejected the law of the Lord. Isaiah 5:16. I'll say that again. Isaiah 5:24. Therefore the Lord is aroused against his people. Okay. So we're preparing you. And you do have angels, and those angels are portrayed as your special guardian, and Michael is portrayed as a special guardian over the people of Israel. That's important. He's a very powerful angel. And if we're so few, which we are, we're so few in number, maybe we'll have the honor of having Michael around just to protect us on Matthew's mountain on the hill. We'll see. We'll see what happens. Now the deal was with Daniel. Here's a point for you. Bear note. Daniel had no idea what was happening in the spiritual realm, but Daniel was praying for 21 days. And Daniel didn't, there's nothing said about Daniel knowing about territorial spirits. You know, like, we know a lot because it's the end time and knowledge will be increased. So we've named off the six territorial types of spirits. But Daniel, there's no indication that Daniel knew what was happening in the spiritual realm that he was praying for 21 days. There is no indication that Daniel was discerning the territorial spirits. That Daniel was praying against the territorial spirits, or that Daniel was even trying to cast them down. Now, I wouldn't dare try to cast them down because they're pretty tough guys, but I'd call on Yeshua to cast them down, and I wouldn't be silent. And if your body gets frozen because there's a big, powerful demon around, and you know, in night terrors, your body gets frozen, you've got to learn to fight those off in your dream. You've got to learn, here's a bear note for you, you've got to learn to fight off night terrors. Where you're frozen and you can't move and you're being attacked by some demon or some situation, you learn to fight it off. You actually take your fist in your dream and swing it. That's right. And those demons will leave you alone, especially if they are the Nephilim type. Because if they're in your room, you know, they've got bodies that can die. They only live to be about 300 years old, especially the little grays. They don't want to get hit in the mouth. They'll leave you alone. It's just a sidebar there. But you've got to resist evil. You've got to resist them. You don't just sit there frozen. So if you're having a night terror dream and you can't move, keep on resisting and try to break free. Don't just lay there in terror. Try to move. Try to move. Try to move your baby finger. Try to move your toe. And then swing at them. Get yourself free. Well, God alludes to this, that we have got to resist evil. That means spiritually, and that means physically also. Now Daniel, as we were saying, had no idea what was happening in the spiritual realm, that the prince of Persia was holding up Michael the archangel. But we know. So we'll pray to the Father to strengthen the angels. And pray to the Father to set his angels all around us so that we can overcome these battles that are going on all around us. That's right. And they are Catechasmeros, Dudamus, and all types of levels of spiritual principalities. And it's in the realm of the spirit beings. And the unfolding events in human history, you know, aren't just on the will of man, because Satan deceives the whole world, and he controls the whole world, and he controls the Committee of 300. And the Committee of 300, by the way, all the Illuminati, bear note, they all believe they're going to live forever. Satan's got them convinced you know, they got cryogenics, and they think that they're going to have scientific advances, that they can revive their dead bodies, and these Illuminati have frozen their bodies in suspended animation. And they're not suspended animation, they're dead, and they'll stay dead until God raises them in the second resurrection, if he even gives them a chance. But here's the point, they've been deceived, that they think they are going to advance technology. Do you know that there is a head transplant that this man has volunteered for? A head, it's going to be happening in the next year. They're going to try a head transplant. I'm not making this up. You can Google that. The point is, the Illuminati think they're going to get new bodies, and they've experimented with, we're not even going to talk about it too much, remote viewing and a whole bunch of other things, and of time travel and going back to the future and then having their bodies restored. Won't get into all that, but I'm telling you this, that they believe they're going to succeed. They believe they're going to defeat Christ, Yeshua. They believe they're going to win the battle of Armageddon. And they actually call us antichrists. That's right. The Catholics' prophecies, all the Catholic prophecies refer to us, the Netzerai, as antichrists, because we're anti-Catholic. Enough said about that. There is more to historical conflict than what meets the eyes. Let's go to 2 Kings, because we're into a historical conflict now, with coming up in a day. So I think we'd better, you know, prepare. We'd better prepare by going through the scriptures here. Let's turn. 2 Kings 6. 15 to 17. 2 Kings 6. Start out in verse 15. And when the servant of the man of God arose early and went out, there was an army surrounding the city with horses and chariots. And his servant said to him, "Alas, master, what'll we do?" Master said so. He answered them, verse 16, "Do not fear, for those who are with us are more than those who are with them." So look, Jade Helm cuts in Monday. Pray that God puts more of his around us than around Satan. Well, verse 17 is the proof here. And Elisha prayed and said, "Lord, I pray, open his eyes that he may see." Then the Lord opened his eyes of the young man, and he saw. And behold, the mountain was full of horses and chariots of fire all around Elijah. Aha. So this mountain, Matthew's mountain, can be full of horses and chariots of fire all around us. So when the Jade Helm comes around us, you have to do something. Okay? So when the Syrians came down on him, because I'm teaching you how to fight now, I'm teaching you how to fight, verse 18. So when the Jade Helm comes around you, Elisha prayed to the Lord and said, "Strike these people, I pray, with blindness." And he struck them with blindness according to the word of Elisha. You can pray that. You can pray that. So look, this is a war. This is a war. You have to know how to fight. So you do what Elisha did. He prayed to the Lord and said, "Strike them." In this case, with blindness. See, you don't just sit around just idly by and not praying in terms of striking them. You don't sit frozen in your bed if you're having a night terror. You fight it off and start wiggling your little finger, and then until you get a fist, and then you start swinging. You break free. You know, there's a type of demon, I shouldn't tell you this, there's a type of demon that actually sits on your chest. I'm not going to tell you any more about it. I'm not going to tell you its name because we don't want you Googling it. We don't want you drawing attention to yourself. But there's even a type of demon that sits on your chest. And that's all I'm going to say. But you fight it off. You fight it off. Now, there are boundaries. There are boundaries. You go to Deuteronomy 32, 7 to 8. Deuteronomy 32. See, we're preparing for the war on Monday. Preparing for the war. So let's go to Deuteronomy 32, 7 and 8. And basically the Lord apportioned groups. Okay. Here, verse 8. When the Most High divided their inheritance to the nations. Now, listen here. Here's the punchline coming. When he separated the sons of Adam, here's the punchline. He set the boundaries of the people according to the number of the children of Israel. So there are boundaries. Like, we're separated from Knoxville. We're separated from Maryville. We're separate here in this little tiny community. And we're looking here that we're told that the Lord apportioned humanity into groupings. He set the boundaries of the peoples according to the number of the sons of Israel. He set the boundaries. It's very important for you to understand that God is in control. Now, do you want to go to Mark 5:10? Swing back to the New Testament here. While we're preparing you for battle. Here, Mark 5, verse 10. And he begged him, that's the demon, begged him earnestly that he would not send them out of the country. That's right, not send them to the abyss. So here's the demons pleading for mercy. So not only can you fight off the demons, you can reverse it so the demons are pleading for mercy. Okay? And this is legion. Here, Mark 5, verse 9. Then he asked him, what is your name? And he answered him, saying, my name is Legion, for we are many. And guess what happened next? This legion begged for mercy. Now a large herd of swine was feeding there near the mountains, so the demons begged him, saying, send us into the swine that we may enter them. And at once Jesus gave them permission, and the unclean spirits went out and entered the swine. There were about 2,000, and the herd ran violently down a steep place into the sea and drowned in the sea. Okay. Remember I told you about Antarctica being a portal, and that Antarctica isn't owned by anybody? And that we lost the war in 1947, we were all shot to bits, our destroyers were shot to bits, we lost the war, well that's where the demons are. So if they went into the sea, the swine went into the sea, I bet the next thing they did is they headed back to Antarctica. And ran violently down into the sea and drowned in the sea. That's what verse 13 says. So that's a supposition. Just a bear note here. They'd be in the sea and then they'd head over to Antarctica through the seas. And by the way, there's all kinds of what you'd call UFOs, you know. But I call them USOs, unidentified submerged objects that come out of the sea all over the place. And they've been reported. I won't go into that, but the point of all of this is that here we've got now the demons begging for mercy. Instead of us begging for mercy on Jade Helm, all according to God's will. So you've got to learn how to fight. Okay? You got to pray to Father. You know, when things happen to you, you pray immediately. You don't think about it. You know, I remember one time, without saying anything, I was able to get out two words.
Help, Father!
That's all I'm going to tell you. And then the situation was resolved immediately. I didn't even get time to say, in the name of Yeshua, which you should say. But I got out two words. So this is telling you how you should prepare yourself the day before Jade Helm. Now, we hope nothing will happen. We hope nothing will happen. But you've got to put on your armor. You've got to put on your armor, because it's going to be terrible. You could have your head cut off if you're taken off to a FEMA camp. You know, not only will you not see Yeshua arrive if you're locked up indoors in a FEMA camp, it doesn't say every eye should see them, so maybe you'll have a window in your FEMA camp cell that you can look out and see Yeshua's light of his arrival. But the point is, you want to be in the place of safety. You don't want to be locked up in a FEMA camp. All right? 2 Corinthians 4:4. Help you fight here. Make a fighter out of you. By the Spirit of God. 2 Corinthians 4:4. Now there were other people whose minds the God of this world has blinded, who do not believe, lest the light of the gospel, which we've been preaching today, the gospel, the good news, the way of life, which includes new month day coming up this Wednesday or Thursday, which includes the four fasts of the Lord coming up on July the 5th. They're blinded. They don't see that. But we do. We do. It's veiled to those who are perishing. You know, our gospel, our ads are veiled. Those three ads. You know, 2 Corinthians 4:3, but even if our ads are veiled, even if God's gospel is veiled to those who are perishing. See, verse 5, we do not preach ourselves, but Christ the Lord Jesus, and ourselves your bondservants for Jesus' sake. So we're commanded, you know, to shine out in darkness, and that's important, and that's what we're doing. But the point is, they're veiled. They don't see anything. They don't see the three ads admonishing them to fill up with oil. You know, it's veiled. They're veiled. Now, we're going to have to put up with the machinations of Satan. I've seen enough trouble in my life to know that, you know, he and his demons are around, and they're not easily dissuaded. And remember, Daniel, it was 21 days. So, let's take you to another level here. Do you know that starting the 15th, you could have 21 days of trouble? Going by what happened to Daniel and Gabriel? You know, we're the only ones preaching the restoration of all things. We're the only ones making straight the paths of the Lord. So it wouldn't surprise me at all if we had 21 days of trouble starting the 15th. Now, I don't want to have 21 days of trouble. You know, and through persistence and through the power of prayer, I will try to resist all evil forces and command them to leave the property in the name of Yeshua or be cast into the abyss before their time. But just like Daniel and Gabriel, we could have 21 days of trouble. So I don't want you to worry if you have 21 days of trouble, because God will rescue us. Will rescue us. Now, we're just about out of time here, so I'm going to skip through the notes and see what I'm dealing with. And watch out. Satan's such a clown. You know, he's a joker, and he doesn't want you alive. And watch out. I got to watch out, because, you know, even the angels don't make a big discussion about Satan. They don't pick on Satan. But there's a song I used to sing, and it had the devil, he's a joker, and he don't want you alive. Well, enough said. I'm not going to cast aspersions on Satan, because that's up to God to do. But here we have a legion of demons that is begging for mercy. So look, we've got power on our side, God willing. Hopefully, we won't have any trouble at all. Everything will just run smooth and we'll go to the place of safety at the proper time. But we are dealing with territorial spirits. And we did get out of the big bad cities like Chicago and Dallas, Washington, D.C. So therefore, hopefully we're not going to be troubled by these powerful, powerful territorial spirits, and we'll not be troubled by the ones that can only be driven out by prayer and fasting, and we're going to be troubled, if we are troubled, by the lesser ones, because I've shown you that there are different levels in this spiritual warfare that we are engaged in. And these rebellious angels oppose those that follow God's Bible. And there's a conflict going on that we do not fight against flesh and blood. We fight against forces, spiritual wickedness in high places. But we also fight. Okay? It doesn't say surrender to forces in high places. It says we contend. Contend means you fight. What does a boxer do? He contends for the crown. I'm contending for my crown. You're contending for your crown. You're fighting. You're a contender. You're a contender for the crown of life. That means you fight for it. You don't just lay down. You don't just stay frozen in your night terrors. Now, it might take you a month or a year to fight free of the night terrors, but I can guarantee you, you will be able to if you fight, if you contend, and indeed, contend for the faith once delivered. Contend for the faith once delivered. Now, you want to stay alive. You want to stay alive. So you want to use common sense. Because if we go to 1 Thessalonians 4:17, 1 Thessalonians 4:17, you want to be riding in the clouds and meet the Lord in the air from the place of safety. That's right. Then we who are alive, 1 Thessalonians 4:17, not we who are dead, then we who are alive and remain, and it does say remain, so that's as opposed to those who didn't fight and didn't remain, shall be caught up together with them in the clouds to meet the Lord in the air, and thus we shall always be with the Lord. Therefore, comfort yourself. Comfort one another with these words. We're going to fight. We're going to contend. We're going to call on the Father and say, help, Father! You're going to contend. You're going to fight against principalities. You're going to fight against dunamis and exousias. You are going to put on the armor of God, and that means the word of truth. The word of truth. And you believed. And you were sealed. You were sealed with the Holy Spirit of God of promise. First Ephesians, or just Ephesians, chapter 1. You're sealed. You're sealed, verse 13. Ephesians 1, 13. You are sealed. In Him you also trusted after you heard the word of truth. Now, we're the only ones giving you all the words of this Bible. I can't help that the other ministers aren't preaching all the words of this Bible. I can't help the other preachers aren't preaching it. But in Him, you also trusted after you heard the word of truth, the gospel of salvation, in whom also having believed, here's the punchline, you were sealed with the Holy Spirit of promise. who is the guarantee. So you've got a guarantee. Not only are you sealed, you've got a guarantee of your inheritance until redemption. And you've been purchased. You're bought. You're his. Of the purchased possession to the praise of his glory. That's the point. That's the point. That you are sealed. You are sealed. You are sealed. Take that to heart. You have been sealed by your following every jot and tittle and his love for you. And it's by grace through faith and not of that of yourself, but because you love God, you obey him. And when you obey him, the Holy Spirit is given to you, and you have the Holy Spirit inside of you. And God is not going to let the temple be kicked down. He is not going to let you lose heart. You have got to hang in there, because things are going to get tough. In conclusion, things are going to be tough, because you go to Lamentations 5 verse 2. I was going to tell you all about this, but we're out of time. But I just want to tell you Lamentations 5 verse 4, what's going on now. We pay for the water we drink. Yeah, you got to pay for your water. You got to get bottled water. There isn't any water in California. All the wells are drying up. You pay for the water you drink. We are in the end times. You pay for the wood. That means you pay for your fuel. Comes at a high price. You know, gas is going to go up to $10 a gallon at least. You know, in Europe it's about $8 a gallon. It's always been high. And we labor and have no rest. We have given our hand to the Egyptians. See, we're in spiritual Egypt right now. And the Assyrians, to be satisfied with just bread. You know, we're working for, we haven't had a wage raise, and oh, it's a horrible situation the way we're in here. But God's going to rescue us. We don't have any funds. We're barely surviving. But it's going to work out. All we've got to do is put on our spiritual armor. You know all about this spiritual armor that you put on. I don't have the time to go into that. But you're going to have persistence, and you're going to fight. And I've taught you how to fight today. You've got it written down in your notes, how to fight. How to put out a fist and fight and have the attitude that you're going to be a survivor. And you're going to fight against the principalities and spirits of wickedness in high places, the dunamis and the exousias and all the rest of the group of six. And if it means that for 21 days we have to wait, like Daniel had to wait, we'll wait. But the good news is Daniel is going to be in the kingdom, and we're going to be in the kingdom, and by faith the just shall live by faith, and our faith is in God. That's the sermon for today.
I hope that strengthened you. It strengthens me.
Just talking about it
strengthens me.
So let's all please rise for the closing hymn. Sorry we didn't get to all the other parts, but we got tons of the Committee of 300. One of these days I'll tell you all about it. Okay, I'll tell you all about the water shortages and HARP and the Vatican connection to the CIA and English words that sound Yiddish. And I got so many notes here. You just look on my desk. Oh, I even forgot to tell, didn't forget, I didn't have time to tell you about the electronic tattoos. The electronic tattoos. As if you're not tattooed already with your cell phone being tracked. And remember I told you they're chipping your tires now? They can tell you wherever you go and wherever you've gone because your new tires have chips in them.
Enough said! We're out of time!
Save me, O God! You're going to ask him to save you. You're going to call out to him to save you. Hymn number 44 in the blue hymnals, 43 in the original hymnals. Save me, say to him, call out to him. This isn't just a song. You're going to ask him to save you from Jade Helm, so that you can see Yeshua arrive in the air, so that you can welcome your king. What would it be like if nobody was around to welcome Christ, eh? Wouldn't that be the pits? You know, he just finishes the big battle and there isn't anybody around because they didn't fight, they didn't strive on. So ask God to save you and you fight against all dunamis and exousias and principalities and hosts of spiritual wickedness. And sing out and ask him, Father El Shaddai, to save you. Standing for the closing prayer, facing the north heavens, arms raised, head bowed in humility, eyes closed in sincerity. Mighty, most loving Father, El Shaddai, with Jade Helm coming up in a day here, we ask you humbly to watch over us. All of our adversaries, sweep them all away. We claim the promises of the 54th Psalm from your Bible. Cast them all off, clean away, so we can go to your place of safety and learn more of your ways in the final training when the jewels will be polished. Father, we love you. We want to work for you. We want to draw closer to you. We want to stay alive so we can know you better and grow in your ways and in your character. So please keep us alive on the hill in Matthew's Mountain, and keep our other members alive in the other parts of the world as we go through these terrible last days, so that we can see Yeshua arrive and indeed cheer him in the air as we come to greet him. Father, we thank you so much for this broadcast. Protect our brethren in Pakistan. We always mention them. And protect us from the state troopers and from the county sheriff's office and from the FEMA and all of the machinations of Satan. And from the revenue department and all the other problems that are around. So now, Father, we want to tell you we love you. No matter what happens, though you slay us, will be faithful. We vow to be faithful to you and never take the mark of the beast and never participate in this evil system. So we are yours, and we ask you to be our helper. As we, your humble children, count on you, Father, to protect us. So now, Father, we ask for your dismissal, and we thank you for this broadcast, and look forward to meeting you in 3 or 4 days for New Month Day. We ask this all in Yeshua's holy righteous name, Yeshua HaMashiach, our soon arriving King of the world. Amen. Yes, indeed. Ask him not to forsake you. So we'll play out with, O God, forsake me not, and that's the broadcast for today.